Good afternoon to you all. I hope you enjoyed your lunch and you are ready for the next exciting session, which is data-driven healthcare. I have two very prominent people from the healthcare industry here, and frankly, I'm very humbled by their presence. I would not even venture to introduce them. So maybe I can request them to give a one-minute introduction about themselves. Arvind, you can go first.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Arvind Shivaramakrishnan, and I'm the Group CIO of Apollo Hospitals. Been with the provider industry now for over 20 years, and run the entire technology-driven healthcare practice that we use at the Apollo Hospitals Group. Our group is 65 hospitals, 40 clinics, 2,700 pharmacies, and 350 telehealth centers, in addition to 40,000 telehealth centers that we run as part of Government of India's Common Services Program, all of them on a technology-connected platform delivering healthcare. Thank you, Raj, for having us.
Hi, I'm Vamsi Kasivajjala. I'm a senior vice president with Bracto, heading their analytics division. Been 18 years in the healthcare industry, built HIS products, implemented them in about 2,000 hospitals across 40 countries, four continents, and then transitioned into analytics, into imaging analytics, and some of the buzzwords and the nice areas that is there in technology now, and we'll talk more about that.
Thanks. Today's session is data-driven healthcare. I'm sure we are all touched by some or other healthcare issues. Healthcare is very close to my heart, and I'm a student of numbers, you know, so I like to study what's going on, how big is the whole industry. Worldwide healthcare in 2015 was about $6.5 trillion, and half of that was represented by US. So US spent about $3 trillion in 2015. By now it must have crossed $3.5 trillion. It is supposed to grow about 6% every year. Next 10 years is going to grow to $6 trillion. So that's a lot of money being spent on healthcare. 50% of that is actually controlled by the government in US. I'll talk about the US first. That kind of numbers had regulators worried because they have to control this cost. You know, most of these costs are literally mandated by the law. They cannot, you know, really withdraw those benefits. These are Medicare patients. These are patients of Veterans Administration, DOD, Department of Defense. Between these three agencies, they control about $1.5 trillion, about 150 million beneficiaries. And that concern was there for quite some time. How do we manage this cost? And as somebody said in the morning, if you can't measure something, you can't manage it. So in about year 2009, regulators introduced incentives for adoption of electronic medical records. And with that incentives, the EMR adoption went from 15% in 2009 to 85% in 2015. Now come to think of it, every other industry has been computerized for a long, long, long time. We are living in third or fourth generation of technology. And healthcare introduced these electronic medical records only in 2015. So there's a lot to happen. Healthcare industry has been behind a lot. I'm sure it's not so in many other countries, but in US it has been really, really behind. In 2016, just last year, they changed the formula for reimbursement to the hospitals and to the providers by providing some incentives for them to report on analytics, report on the quality of service. Basically what they said was, there's a formula which was used earlier, fee for service. If doctor spends 30 minutes, they get paid that much money. So they changed the whole formula. They said, look, starting from 2017, we're going to introduce a number of measures which will basically force the providers to manage their cost. And if they are not able to manage the cost, they will either get incentive or disincentive. And the numbers were huge, 9% incentive, 9% disincentive. Many of these hospitals work on 2 to 3% margin. So they are going to be forced to adopt big data, forced to adopt analytical measures. That's the only way they can control these costs. So that's what has led to a number of megatrends, which I will briefly mention about. That's again applicable to US, but I'm sure many of these will be found beneficial in other parts of the world. So healthcare is moving from volume to value. So there's a lot more emphasis on value-based services. The fee-for-service method is going to be basically extinct, you know, in a few years' time. Emergence of risk-based healthcare. So they are providing, for example, bundled payment care initiative. There are about 120 procedures like kidney transplant, like knee replacement. They are providing for some total cost to be reimbursed to hospitals. Within those total costs, they have to manage surgery time, they have to manage all other testing, diagnostics, and imaging and everything. With that, the role of non-physician providers is going to definitely go high because they cannot afford to provide that much of physician time if they're going to manage within those costs, you know. There's an increased importance of quality metrics, you know. There are a number of payment procedures. They are called quality payment program. There is a merit-based incentive program. All these are basically to encourage hospitals and physicians to adopt quality-based measures. US is still behind, by the way, in many parts, as compared to many parts of the world. Although US spends about 40% more on healthcare per capita as compared to the next country, the life expectancy has not gone up that much. US is still about 17th or 18th place in the world in life expectancy. Another mega trend which we see a lot is the rise of mobile, you know, technology. You know, you look at any sector, whether it's booking of airline tickets or doing your banking, you have access to a lot of applications. You have access to basically all kind of facilities. Healthcare is still behind. There is not much of mobile technology adoption yet in US. I'm sure it is not the same case in many parts of the world. The power of smartphones. You know, smartphone is like a computer almost you carry with you. The right care, the right place, the right time. That's what's going to happen soon in healthcare, which was not there before. Again, because non-adoption of electronic records. You know, value through data, the dynamic use of information to improve decision making, the increase in data-driven discovery, evaluation, innovation for drugs and medical devices, the facilitation of clinical trials with big data. These are all trends which we are going to see a lot in future. The other trend we see a lot is predict, prevent, personalize. The transformational impact of genomics, epigenetics, predictive diagnostics, we see that happening a lot in near future. And because now we have the facility or we have the means to collect data on all the patient records. The power of artificial intelligence based clinical support, you know, we see a lot happening. I have seen in last 6 months, at least 6 to 7 companies funded big time to just manage accountable care organization. Again, the bundled payment care initiative. So there's a lot happening. And but I still think the field is pretty ripe, you know, open for innovation. And I personally think India can really lead that effort, you know, in the innovation. Healthcare is going global. You know, there are a lot of stuff that is done right now: telemetry or telemedicine or remote diagnostics. The globalization of delivery of healthcare. We see that happening a lot. You know, these are some of the mega trends we see happening as a result of adoption of electronic medical records and the computer technology. Maybe, you know, I can ask our panelists, esteemed panelists, to give their views on what's happening, you know, in this part of the world.
Sure. Arvind, you want to take it? So, if you look at what's going on in India, and, so Raj was mentioning about the US going into volume to value. India is the king of value. We've grown with the culture of value, and any of you have seen any advertisements related to healthcare, you would have seen for clear that, you know, there's going to be this thing, total knee replacement that can be done in so many, in within this cost. So the concept of packages in India as a as a retail concept, not just in healthcare, but in anything that we do, we always go for this bundled offer in whatever we buy, has been prevalent in the Indian sector for a very, very long time. Take the largest Indian healthcare reimbursement agent, if I may call it, that's CGHS, the Central Government Health Scheme. Though it's not strictly an insurance payer as such, CGHS kind of caters to the massive central government employees, which is the largest workforce in the country. And if you look at the reimbursement model, it is clearly based only on value and it is not based on volume. And that value, it further takes it into the various items that they use in the process of healthcare that force quality. So this is not a bring down the cost conversation. Yes, we want the healthcare cost to be low, but it should be at a sustainable level so that the quality is not lapsed on it. And this is something that is very, very essential part. And if I take things into the quality aspect, it is almost now become mandatory that every laboratory that is doing diagnostic services or laboratory biochemistry, lab services are NABL accredited, National Accreditation Board of Laboratories. And these kind of, now with India in this stage of the digital economy, give a huge boost to this industry segment as such. While India needs to learn from the West, it's got strong advantages. So India now has the ability to move a little forward because it doesn't need to live through the same administrative issues that the West has been going through. Let's take an analogy example. The West knew electronics and computers since the 1960s. There were mainframe computers. The West and the Europe were very big on the mainframe computers. Then came the PC era. After the PC era came the web e-commerce timeline. India was never part of the mainframe. I don't think any of us grew up with mainframes other than learning it in one of our semester courses, and maximum it was a 3-mark question also. We really didn't pay too much attention to mainframe. I do remember in those days, you know, COBOL and BASIC were courses that people used to go to keep themselves occupied for summer vacation, really not a serious course that was done because we grew up in that age. And India was able to transition completely into the e-commerce, web, mobile generation without having to live through that. So this is not, the reason I'm quoting this as an example, this is not that you need to graduate into every step and then only you can get into a mature healthcare player in your country, in your society, and obviously internationally. Look at our manpower. Though we are definitely as an industry far, 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 far short, so I'm not even going to venture into numbers because our numbers on the healthcare manpower is very, very low, regrettably low. So it's not about, but the quality of our students coming out is reasonably good. Can it be better? Yes. Is there aspiration for higher? Clearly, yes. But manpower is, in India, an advantageous position, though it is way short of numbers. Cost in terms of services being provided is low. The ability to mix technology to drive healthcare is high. For all elective services, India clearly is a destination for world healthcare. And that is why you see medical tourism thriving in India. I'm not just talking from my organization's perspective. I'm talking of this as an industry segment. And for India, With technology-driven healthcare in India, our market size is way bigger that you need to worry about anybody trying to become a monopoly here. Our market size is too big, and so monopoly is definitely not a problem at this point in time. God, I know, you know what? Monopoly will be a wonderful day to see, because that day, that means we've got healthcare for everybody at maximum efficiency level. So if we have complaints of monopoly, we've achieved that level of maturity. We are nowhere in that zone. That with the technology industry, if the technology industry is playing well with the healthcare industry, you have an economy growing, you've jobs created, you have better services provided to the community. Overall, the cost of economy of, sorry, cost of healthcare without any subsidy is kept in logical control. I'm meaning logical control. I'm not meaning low cost so that it is free or in a number that is nice to have. So this is not a 2 rupee rice discussion. And again, I'm giving that analogy because we've all been through in each of our states, whether it's Karnataka or Andhra or Tamil Nadu or Uttar Pradesh, we've heard the 2 rupee rice, 5 rupee rice, 1 rupee rice. We've all heard about it. And as reasonable people who understand the economy, we know what it has done to the economy. So we don't need to get into that trap ever again. If rice costs 20 rupees a kilo, so be it, as opposed to making it 2 rupees a kilo, because the 18 rupees is being paid out of the taxpayers' money. And some other section is going to pay for it, which is not desirable in any economy. So when you look at that, India today is doing pretty well as a young economy in healthcare that is capable of growth. To talk about the government, what's going on in the government, and I'm part of the National Electronic Medical Records Council, as well as the government is for, and you would have seen the last about 3 weeks, 4 weeks back, the National Health Policy was announced. As part of the National Health Policy, there was a very important paragraph that was written on the National Digital or e-health authority. And that is like a try. Because once you bring e-health or digital health, I'm not going to argue on e-health versus digital, that's not the argument at all. Once that is there, you need a governing body that is able to administer those services so that it is doing what it is supposed to do and reaching out at all levels of service, affordability and cost. All of this put together with accountability on quality. Without that, it just becomes a random service. And in healthcare, a random service is a danger to society and the economy. So with all of this put together, the government is formulating this, and God willing, it should come out probably next year. I'm giving it next year because with monsoon session over and a winter session going on, and now thankfully parliament functioning, I'm sure bills will get passed. Wishful thinking. But with that going on, the government is putting enough thrust on keeping that benefit to the society, to the larger, whether it's a public or a private. I'm a firm believer that you can't push everything into the government domain because nobody can afford it. You just can't look at affording. Now, with all of this coming together, in India, data is abundant. Why? We are a country of 1 billion people. We'll take down anybody on numbers. We'll take down anybody on numbers. Like, you know, we gave all the cell phone companies a run for their technology because we take down numbers like this. We've seen numbers that nobody can see. We are a country of, so that numbers is immediately there. Hence, the ability to do data-driven, big data, data, analytics, I am not going to informatics, there are several words that we can coin. The purpose is, what are we learning from it and implementing in our workflow So in healthcare terms, we call that evidence-based medicine driven by pathways and protocols. Evidence-based medicine, I'm not talking of something that is mandated, because in healthcare, mandating is not the right way to do, but following a regiment is there. Raj spoke about alternate medicine. You need to teach India alternate medicine? Come on. We originated Ayurveda. Homeopathy is known to us. Our grandma giving us alternate medicine for common problems that we face, cold, cough, fever, stomach pain, headache, is well, we've grown up in that culture. And we have an Ayush, Ayurveda, Yunani, Homeopathy, Siddha. We have a ministry that does Ayush, that is part with the allopathic. So we don't have a problem with that. And we have enough schools and colleges that graduate Ayurvedic, Homeopathic, Siddha, Yunani doctors, educated doctors from universities going through a regime of care. That the education with data, where we are lacking today, is driving that into the workflows to derive the efficiencies. Are we getting the advantage of our numbers? No, 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 no. Why? How much of pharmaceutical research to drive new medicines to treat diseases has originated from India and been used in India? You can count few numbers in your hand. Isolated cases, which is not norm. So we are doing bad in that front, which is a huge area of opportunity. I mean this opportunity, I don't mean that from a passion standpoint. I mean that as an economy, I mean that as making money, I mean that as driving employment, I mean that as overall social upliftment that brings the society up. There's money in it, there's good money in it, there's intellectual money in it. This is an area that is of huge, and we have great schools like IIT and IISc and all of them that are capable of giving us that analytical thinking, that engineering thinking coupled with medicine, that also we have. It's an area of improvement in India. Overall driving adoption, probably we can discuss as we go, but this is where I see India and where opportunities and weaknesses exist.
Thank you. Vamsi,
sure.
You have been quiet.
That's fantastic. That's a provider's perspective, right? The largest in the country, and definitely in Asia. But always have a challenge of being in a panel after lunch.
That's
where the audience is either sleeping or I'm sleeping.
So, or we are too good that they don't have a question, which is the better way I would like to think.
So I just wanted to see, out of this audience, how many of you are technical guys who actually do development? Okay, very few hands. I see about 15 hands. Or how many of you are sales and marketing? Okay, so there's about 10, 12 hands. How many of you are clinicians, doctors, nurses? I know there is one doctor sitting there. Anybody else? So it's predominantly technology and sales, right? So then I'm going to have my presentation according to that. So where is the opportunity? I loved where Arvind stopped, right? It's all about show me the money, honey, right? So there is a huge potential. I mean, analytics is a great market. Do we have any startups over here? Oh, great. Healthcare? Awesome. So there is a huge challenge because we are living in a renaissance era of medicine, okay? Because medicine is one of those industries. In fact, medicine is not a science. It's an observational art. And from the time Sushruta to Ibn al-Sana to Hippocrates to Grants, it's been observational. But first principles, like for example, you look at go in an aeroplane and let's say one in 100 takeoffs actually crash. We'll not accept that. But one in 100 let's say a complex multi-bypass surgery, the risk rate probably is what? 27%, 30%?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and about that range.
So statistically, one in three will die. Okay, acceptable. So medicine is changing. And when I say medicine, it's just not the way medicine is practiced, but the very fundamental essence, you know, that's where the specific aspects of genomics, epigenetics, all kinds of omics, the fundamentals of medicine is being found out. And it's very, very new, right? I mean, if you really look at it, the first gene therapy that has been given permission was in 2016, last quarter, 2017, first quarter. So from the time that we found out DNA to actually having a gene therapy which is allowed to be performed took us 40 years. So you're living in a great era. So everywhere you look, you'll see a Leonardo da Vinci, a Michelangelo. So we've got a few of them over here, a few startups, right? This is exactly what it is. So it's a great place to be in. Now, what does really all these words of big data, so big data or whatever, it boils down to a simple thing. If you have large enough data, you will be able to find patterns which are repeatable. And hence you can say this can potentially occur with a very high probability. That's what it basically means. There's also a nice funny saying, right? If you torture data long enough, it will confess. So you keep doing that, you'll get to know the answer. So I'll actually show you a few examples. So typically analytics will have a bunch of things. So you start with BI. Which most of the hospitals, like let's say for example in India, will also require. So there is an opportunity out there. So for example, so Arvind will get a call in the morning from his COO if he doesn't see how yesterday's performance was. And it's extremely critical, right? So every hospital needs to know what was the performance yesterday. And it's just not revenue numbers. It is like, are there any critical cases? Have there been any challenges yesterday? So they need to understand that information. The moment they wake up, for them to run their hospital, they need information. So you need dashboards. The second thing is basically predictive analytics. Can we, so I'll give you a case in point example, right? And we have Arvind, we have HCG over here. So they can tell me if I'm wrong. But the way hospitals predominantly in India have run campaigns is based upon cancer weak, diabetes weak, and so on and so forth. And they have a campaign with that. This is other than the health camps and other things that they're looking at. But as Arvind was saying, right, slowly data-driven things are happening. So I'll give you an example. Except for the doctors here, how many of you know what is a transient ischemic attack? Okay. So it's basically a reversible stroke. So stroke can put it, is paralysis, that what is how you most of the people would know. So what happens is for a few seconds, the blood flow stops to the brain. And because of which the patient suddenly will not be able to move the limbs and so on and so forth, it'll start stammering, slurring, and the patient then will be fine after a few minutes, and the patient will rush to the doctor. The doctor will knows that it's a transient ischemic attack, will ask the patient to walk in a straight line to see if there are any lingering effects. If there are none, then the patient will be asked to get an MRI of the brain done. Now, typically a patient above 60, 1 in 10 cases, they could potentially have an aneurysm, which is basically like a bulge in a vial. So that can potentially rupture and the blood will flow out. There would be a clotting, hemorrhage, and death. So when you look at a radiology report, you can apply something like an NLP and you can natural language processing, and you can come back and say, hey, there is an aneurysm, so which means it needs a ballooning, which is also known, there's also a procedure called digital subtraction angiography. So if we potentially, this is a potential targeted customer list that you can get for the hospital. So which basically means that they can make per patient about 2.5 to 3 lakh rupees, depending upon what kind of a hospital it is. So which is a targeted campaign, and this is exactly what we are used to, right? In e-commerce, a Flipkart and Amazon, based upon a book or a dress that you have bought, it immediately sends you something out there. Now, that's data-driven, targeted campaign list, and that's what you can potentially call it as a marketing analytics. Now, you can forecast revenue for them. So people in pharmacies pharma companies, right? Sales forecasting, territory alignment, and so on and so forth, has been there forever. From a provider perspective, you know, slowly the revenue forecasting, ALOS optimization, average length of stay optimization. So these are the things that can potentially happen. And my favorite is clinical predictive analytics. Right? Can I predict whether someone will get a heart attack, an atrial fibrillation? Can I predict someone, when would someone get hypertension? When would someone get diabetes? And don't be surprised, there are a whole lot of organizations which are actually working on this. And they're pretty, so if some, there's some organizations when they tell you you'll get hypertension in the next 6 months, you will get hypertension, otherwise they will come and ensure that you get hypertension. So this is where technology is going to, because of multitude of factors. Now let's really look at them. So I'll give you an example of imaging analytics. So typically a doctor will look at a chest x-ray, needs to look at a chest x-ray to say whether the patient has got tuberculosis or not, okay? Now, similarly, you know, there's an ophthalmologist who will look at your retinal scans, look at the fundoscopic images. And then if he feels that you could potentially be a diabetic retinopathy case, he would send it to a retinopathist who will look at that and say, you are a type 3, type 4, that is a proliferative diabetic retinopathy case, which means you will become blind. That's what it means. And for every 10,000 ophthalmologists, on an average, about 50 to 100 retinopathists or in some kind of a ratio like that basically exists, a 1 is to 200, 1 is to 300. So which means there is a workflow problem. So someone who is running a large eye clinics to get this done, they probably will send it from Delhi to Chennai because Chennai has got the largest number of retinopathists in this country. And it will take 24 hours, 48 hours for that information to go back. So there is a workflow problem. So you can actually solve that. So I'll give you an example of a tuberculosis in this case. What it basically does is it has the ability that you can take a portable x-ray machine to a village. You take that x-ray, you run your deep learning neural networks, and it comes back and tells you, with obviously clinical information, comes back and tells you this patient has an 85% probability of having tuberculosis, which means someone has to look at that case right now. It says 20% probability of having tuberculosis, which means someone can look at that, a radiologist can look at that case, you know, probably in 3-4 days time, but there's nothing urgent out there. So how does it work? How many of you, there are a whole lot of hands from a technology perspective. How many of you do Python or R, coding in Python or R? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yeah, there are about 10 odd people, great. So this is based on R. It's a convolutional neural network that has been used to get this. You basically upload the image and you activate the prediction model. It's basically pattern recognition for both electronics courses and computer science courses have existed for about 30, 40 years, I guess. So I definitely studied 20 years ago. It was there. It's just that the way things are happening now, you have better models, you have more computation power, things that can be done pretty fast. So when you take a portable x-ray machine and take, for example, in a health camp, you take an x-ray out there, within 90 seconds, you can get a response like this, which basically says that, in this case, you can see that it says tuberculosis discovered, or there is tuberculosis basically out there. And these are pretty accurate, and it's running out there. So imaging analytics, deep learning is an extremely hot space. So that's something that you can potentially look at. This is more of technical details. So this is what I was speaking about in atrial fibrillation. This is a machine learning model using kernel SVMs. So it's a vector model out there. You have the ability to say that, you know, tell me in the next 30 days how many cases of atrial fibrillation will I get. So it actually goes back and gives you, these are your patients. When you click on that, it'll come back and say, there is a 75% or an 87.5% probability of this patient getting an atrial fibrillation in the next 25 days, or and so on and so forth. So what does it mean? So maybe in this case, you can get regular lab tests done to ensure and have probably some medications available. But if you're looking at the same thing in a respiratory case, or someone with an asthma, someone with COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder, the ability to predict over the next 52 weeks in which week they will actually get an attack. You can't stop an attack from occurring, but you can actually ensure that they carry their medication, their inhalers with them, so hospitalization could be stopped. Now that's basically a complete value perspective in the US. So you can apply these machine learning models to actually predict even clinical conditions from occurring or when they would occur. This is an example of Houston, and each of those dots are individual human beings. And it is basically saying that how many of these patients are prone or have a higher risk of getting an influenza-like illness in winter or towards the end of summer. So basically flu cases are very high over there. And this is actual data that we're looking at over here. So the ones in the red are the ones who will definitely get it, or high probability of basically getting that. And it tells you how these models basically run, what is the probability of getting them that, and which vaccination, which vaccines that they need to procure based upon the kind of viruses that are there, or what strains of viruses would potentially occur in that year in that particular region, and hence what should I stockpile, which is a big problem in the United States. This is an example of Pune, and this is all real data that we are looking at. So based upon a simple PSA lab test, you can actually have prostate cancer triggers. In the next 2 years, which patient has a potential of getting a prostate cancer? And you can actually have triggers and would work in that. So there are an immense amount of things that you can actually work in this space. It's fascinating. It's cutting edge technology. It will help patients. It'll help hospitals to optimize their costs, increase their revenues, and improve the patient care. So just a few things I wanted to share.
Thank you very much, Vamsi. I guess we have about 12 minutes for Q&A. If I may, I get to ask the first question. I'm always curious about, for example, privacy laws. You know, in many parts of the world, USA, Europe, there are very strict privacy laws. You know, no employee of hospital, unless they really have a need or authorized, can access even patient records, you know, or patient data. How about in India? You know, how are the privacy laws evolving? Or
the privacy laws in India currently are evolving. So this is going to be part of the National eHealth Authority, where the privacy and security rules of handling electronic data, disseminating electronic data, is going to be elaborately discussed, including the ability to use anonymized data and de-identified data, in what manner it shall be done, and how it can be done to ensure that if a particular consumer wants to opt out of it, how it shall be done. So those are something that are evolving now. Hopefully we should see this put as a law, and when I say law, done as an act of parliament and enforced onto the country. Probably next year is what I would, again, wishful thinking that I expect it to happen. As it exists currently, so having said that's something that's going to happen and the timeline is anybody's guess, what exists today is the IT Act. We all know the IT Act is sketchy, but the IT Act does exist. So it is wrong for me to say that privacy laws do not exist in India. They are very much existing today as we speak. Our vigor of enforcing them is exceptionally weak. What is going to come is a much more profound and effective law. It does not mean we don't have today. Unfortunately, we are not taking it seriously. We are not enforcing it and we are not practicing it. There are laws where you are supposed to give a valid identification at the time of registering for a healthcare service. None of us have ever given any ID card. To that matter, when you are asked for an ID card, you yell at the top of their voice so the counter staff get more scared and they back off asking for your ID, then actually they do it. So that's what it's getting into. The big question of, is Aadhaar getting into healthcare? At this point in time, it is being thought of. There's nothing that is being enforced. But as it is being thought of, it is being done in a manner that does not deny healthcare or primary healthcare or emergency healthcare. So if I am knocked out, you will not come and ask me what is your Aadhaar number. You will definitely take care of me and then only worry about my... And that is more being done with the intention of bringing in the longitudinal record from a health information exchange, a concept that is still evolving in the country. That is what it is being done, not as a prohibitory aspect of putting numbers to deny care. No, it is not being done. It is putting numbers to ensure that care is given to you. So if you are able to get my identity and through my social circles, get that information, so even though I am not in a state to communicate, you know my allergies, care will be better delivered and care will be delivered faster. That is how it's being done. Laws exist today, not enforced. There is a lot of discrepancy and ways in which it can be interpreted, which is what is getting fixed. But it does exist today.
We'll open.
I just wanted to add to that. Just an interesting fact. India probably is the only country where there is a law which says that the patient is the owner of the data which is there at a hospital or a clinic. In the US, out of the 50 states, only one state, the patient owns it. In 47 states or 46 states, it's owned by the hospital. In a couple of states, there is no law. And health, even in India, is a state subject. It's not a central subject, very similar to the United States. And this is interesting. So you can actually go ask a hospital to give you a copy of your record, and they have to mandatorily give it to you. I think the time frame is 7 years, I guess.
Correct.
That you have to do it. And there is a law, and you have a right to that. So it's a little different from privacy, but I thought it's an interesting fact.
You. Any questions from the audience? We have microphones available, please.
So, what kind of infra...
can you identify yourself, your name?
Yeah. My name is Ram, and I'm from Modastra Technologies. And so, a lot of many things involved related to the healthcare we are doing. We are building the healthcare contents, basically, in multilingual here in Bangalore, Whitefield. So, just wondering, all over the place in Bangalore, when I was here since last 14 years, I went to Manipal, I went to Apollo, I went to so many places. So my data is all over scattered. So how I myself will be sure about credibility of my own data, and of course coming out the report as a authenticity of that report, and what action further should be taken? Because since last 3-4 years, I am with near neighbor hospital Columbia Asia. So what centralized body is doing to at least in some controlled fashion that data should be gathered and consolidated, and then individually report is given. That's one thing. Second thing, from the governance perspective, since you guys are sitting over there and talking all the regulation and other things, how it going to support each other? Like Manipal will support Apollo, Apollo supporting Columbia Asia, and so what kind of governmental thing is coming so that everything is come under one umbrella? So tomorrow when analytics things has got applied and some report has come, I myself is sure, hey, this is truth. Truthness is here. Here I have to take action on this. It's a proactive measure. Here is a prescriptive measure. And here there is prediction about that. So to just want to understand from you. Thanks.
I'll first address your question in terms of what sort of quality measures are being put. So this is where comes in regulations, meaning quality regulations such as the Joint Commission International, which accredit healthcare institutions. It's an international accreditation on patient quality and safety. In India, there is what is called the NABH, National Accreditation Board of Hospitals, and NABL, National Accreditation Board of Laboratories. They set standards in terms of how information has to be read, understood, collected, interpreted, and disseminated, and how checks and balances have to be done so that statistically and periodic basis, it is verified. Just like any quality check done in any quality parameter that we can think of, those exist, they are governing and they are penalizable. So that's what is being done to ensure that people adhere to quality. So to a very direct question of what you are probably trying to allude to, and I'll probably break it in very blunt terms, is my blood test being read by a qualified person or any general janta is reading it and putting some value? This is where the accreditation comes, where you're supposed to be reporting to these agencies and they will do random. Plus, India has matured to a certain extent now that these accredited bodies go through anytime audits. Anytime audits. So NABH and NABL can just announce at 7 o'clock this morning that they are coming to your hospital at 9 o'clock and you do not have a choice of refusing them.
And there is a penalty attached to
non. There is a penalty and your accreditation will be lost and that information will be published. So this is not like a stage managed audit. That level of maturity exists. Is that level of adoption and furthering there as a society, as a country, as a large? I think we lack in the overall aspect. I'll come to your question, sir, sorry. But next question you had asked me was, how will you help Apollo and Manipal and Columbia Asia bring in their data? Sorry, sir, I disagree with you. Don't think that in that manner. The way Vamsi said, the data belongs to the patient. Why are you bringing in these providers and working around them? Work around the center of the universe. The center of the universe in healthcare is the patient. Work around the patient. Do not work around the provider. Because if you work around the provider, and I know you are recording this session and God help me for that, and I'm going to run my appraisal into risk now. But if you work around, it's going to be beneficial to the provider. I'll put my own isms into how it should be done, which is not around the center of our universe. So a health information exchange works around that. Laws around it are very weak at this point in time, but individual practitioners, like in Apollo, we have what is called the Apollo Prism, which is a kind of a health information exchange. Do multiple people participate? Those who are interested participate. There is no law that is binding. But when we talk of a proper disease surveillance, population health management and a HIE, everybody will be inclined to participate, because not because of law. When you take that data, apply that into big data analytics, feed it back into workflows that drive efficiency in organizations, organizations will participate. If you just make it mandatory by law to participate, I will go and get a stay and I know what can happen after that. We've all experienced that. That is not the way to approach it. The way to approach it is the intelligence that our system can drive, then people will participate.
Thank you.
We are still pretty nascent in that.
Thank you. Is there one question this side, please? You know, she was there before.
Oh, me? Yeah. Can I?
Please. Please.
So, again, my name is Deepanjali. Work at HCG, like you mentioned. My only question is, yes, this big data applications and also the data-driven medicine and all that, you know, it was pretty impressive. And also the clinical trends that you were talking about following, yes, that's also very impressive. But, you know, I would be very sad if I went to my oncologist and my oncologist says, ma'am, you're at stage 4, might as well not give you any treatment, go home. Have we lost with some kind of a human touch with this technology coming in and giving so much data out and so much trends out? And how would we handle that in an emotional country like India? We are very emotional.
It's a very touchy point.
I mean,
right?
Just a thought. I mean, how would you want to handle that?
So again, I would come back. So let's say, for example, forget technology, right? 20 years ago, a patient would go with a breast cancer, with a skin cancer, with a prostate cancer, the patient would go over there to the doctor, and the doctor would say, you know, there's a particular lady who has gone and said, you're a stage 4 cancer, you have 30 days to live. Okay. From then to now, what has changed? So technology will now tell you, instead of 30 days, it'll probably tell you 120 days before that you are almost approaching stage 4. Nothing else has changed. But where we are coming in from, right, And when I say and I mean it, and I believe in this, that we're living in a Renaissance era of medicine. This is like the 16, 1700s when we had Michelangelo and Da Vinci and everyone, because healthcare is truly becoming a science. We are understanding the building blocks far better than what it was. HCG itself has invested so much of money into understanding genomics. And when would a gene switch on and off? Why would something happen out there? What is cancer? A cell which doesn't die, has no purpose, so can it be translated into something else? The ability of way science and technology are being utilized in medicine today. And because, and finally, for heaven's sake, people have realized that yaar, jaan hai to jahan hai. If we exist, this world exists. So which means we have started putting money not into finance, into e-commerce, into other things, but finally there is a huge amount of money that is being put into the healthcare industry for startups, right? The highest amount in the quarter that ended, the highest amount of money actually went into healthcare for the first time ever in the United States. $1.6 billion was invested. No other industry came. This should have happened 100 years ago. A disease like Alzheimer's, which is found out 110 years ago, doesn't have, we don't even know why it occurs. We don't have medications for that. So when you say this, absolutely, the doctor needs to be very nice. There is a human touch, there is everything. But my request and way I look at it is that please embrace technology to ensure that healthcare, medicine becomes a science and not an observational art. Oh, this might work, and hence I'll try that.
Well, okay, one last question from my side.
Next session has to start. Sure. Both the panelists are here, so maybe what we can do is we can take our questions offline if you don't mind, because next panel is waiting for us. Okay. With that, thank you very much, both the panelists. Let's say give a big hand to both of them.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
I'd like to request moderator to please present a small bit of our appreciation to our panel members. I'd like to request you to please give them a big round of applause once again, ladies and gentlemen.